Well, I decided that I would give a talk today about the question whether antipsychotic medications can cause or worsen mania. With mania can also come psychosis. So you could extend this to ask the question, can they cause or worsen mania or psychosis? But it's going to focus primarily on the possibility that these medicines can induce mania. Why would we ask this question? I mean, aren't these drugs widely tested? Aren't they approved for the treatment of bipolar disorder? And how can a medicine that's supposed to help with bipolar disorder, help with mania, possibly wind up causing it? So why I'm asking this question is because I get asked this question quite a bit. I meet people from time to time who claim that they can't take insert name of antipsychotic medication there. They can't take such and such a medicine because that made them experience psychosis or made their bipolar disorder worse. And I feel that I get this question often enough that most likely you have heard it or read it from time to time. The other thing I think it's worthwhile to just consider is that I mentioned at the beginning, these drugs are approved to treat bipolar mania. So how could a medicine that's supposed to be good for mania cause mania? I'll get to that question of how at the end of the talk, but just keep in mind that double-blind, placebo-controlled, registrational drug clinical trials are designed specifically to show whether the drug in question outperforms placebo in, reducing symptoms of mania. It is an entirely different design to ask a question, can this medicine make psychosis happen? Can it make mania worse? And if this is a relatively or very rare side effect, you're going to need extremely large sample size and a different focus of analysis to be able to get to that question. So essentially, yes, the drug trials that led to approval demonstrate that they outperform placebo at reducing mania, but these trials were not designed to ask to answer any other question, basically. So the idea that they might worsen mania, it's on the table. And think about it. If you're a clinician and you're giving a medicine to try to reduce mania and the mania doesn't go away or the mania gets worse, are you likely to think that my drug is causing or worsening the condition? Or are you likely to think that the drug is just not working well enough? The mania has naturally gotten worse on its own, and therefore I need more of the medicine. You're using an atypical antipsychotic drug to treat somebody with schizophrenia, and during the course of treatment, you start to see symptoms of mania or hypomania emerging. It is probably more natural to suspect that this new symptom represents a natural feature of the illness that is poorly responsive to medicine, and the idea that the medicine actively caused that symptom to arise is doesn't occur to most people. So I think, putting that question on the table is worth it. And because, as bullet point three says, logic simply requires that you consider the possibility that the medicine is making things worse in cases where symptoms are not getting better or where symptoms are getting worse. So if A is present when B is present, you need to consider the possibility that A caused B. It's not necessarily going to be the case that it did, but I think it's unwise and illogical not to, not to fully consider that. So that's why I wanted to put this question out there to consider. So now that I've asked the question, is there any evidence that antipsychotic medications might cause or worsen mania? And short answer is, I started to make a bibliography, and this is not by any means complete. But here you see aripiprazole, amisulpride, quetiapine, risperidone, olanzapine. Here's another page of references with similar titles, another page of references with similar titles, another page of references with similar titles. Point is, there's a lot of case reports. How many? Well, Rashid and colleagues in 2004 did a Medline search. They just looked at one database of a four-year period and identified 34 cases in which antipsychotic medications appeared to produce mania or hypomania. The occurrences occurred across a wide range of drugs, as you can see. And then in 2012, Benyamina and Samalin looked, you know, they reinvestigated the literature. So they noted the cases that Rashid and others had done from 93 to 2000, from 99 to 2003. Benyamina and Samalin looked at cases from 94 to 2010, so a 6-year period, and they identified 81 additional cases in, you know, beyond those that Rashid had identified and others. And again, wide range, risperidone, olanzapine, ziprasidone. These were not designed to try to estimate likelihood. It's not ranking ordering. In other words, the fact that risperidone had 22 cases and aripiprazole had only 4 shouldn't be interpreted as risperidone is more risky. It could just be that risperidone is an older medication, and so there may have been more use. And again, this is not a systematic investigation. The point of this is that there are cases, to be clear, between 1994 and 2010, there probably were millions of prescriptions written for these medicines, and 81 case reports were reported. So probably it's very rare, but not zero. And as I said, certainly supports the possibility that it could happen. And the point of this is that it can happen with a variety of different medicines. I don't think we have any way to know which medicine is more likely to provoke mania than others at this time. So bottom line, it is possible. How might that happen? In the case of the partial agonists, aripiprazole, brexpiprazole, and cariprazine, these turn on the dopamine receptor. So they actually activate dopamine receptors, although they activate it part way. So if we could have theoretically turning on a dopamine receptor to 100%, a drug like aripiprazole turns it on to 30 or 40%. So partial agonist. But still, that is some drive or some push on a dopamine system. Take as an aside, in conditions like psychosis, in which it's thought that there's been that there is an excessive release of dopamine, then having a drug which turns on the receptor to only 30 or 40% of its maximum ability to transduce signal is effectively a reduction of dopamine signal throughout that circuit. So rather than 100%, you're sitting at 40%. So it's a relative reduction. However, there may be in some people and in some brain regions a relative inactivity of dopamine, and then having a partial agonist to turn on that system actually is a stimulatory signal. And some people may be sensitive to that. Indeed, in the case of aripiprazole, for example, aside from the possibility that it could induce mania or hypomania, there are many reports of aripiprazole inducing impulsive behaviors such as gambling or impulsive sexual indiscretions. That's probably represents the fact that it's finding those people that have interesting brain chemistry in whom they can have this pro-dopamine effect working against them. So one possible mechanism for atypical antipsychotic drugs, at least the partial agonist family, to induce mania or hypomania is stimulating dopamine systems in people that are sensitive to that kind of stimulation. Most, to the extent that we have any consensus, and again, most of these, and in fact, all of these mechanisms that I'm going to talk about are speculative. Most of the speculation revolves around the fact that the atypical antipsychotic drugs are serotonin 2A receptor antagonists. That's what makes atypical drugs atypical. Without getting super nerdy, when you block the 2A receptor for serotonin, and particularly when you block it simultaneously with blocking dopamine receptors, you have multiple circuit effects which translate into more dopamine being released, you know, a higher level of extracellular dopamine available in motor circuits, like in the striatum. So that the fact that 2A serotonin antagonism in combination with D2 antagonism raises dopamine in the striatum accounts for the fact that these drugs have lower extrapyramidal side effects. In other words, that's what makes them atypical, most likely. But it's not just in the striatum that you have higher availability of dopamine. You can also have this happening in reward circuits or in motivational areas or areas devoted to executive functioning, such as prefrontal cortex. And that's one of the theories whereby atypical antipsychotic drugs might provoke mania or hypomania or have, I guess, other undesirable psychiatric adverse effects or potentially desirable ones, depending upon the circumstances of the patient. And then a variation of the dopamine elevation is an idea that there may be simultaneous dopamine and norepinephrine elevation that in the case of lurasidone is thought to be due to its serotonin 1A partial agonism effect. In animals, you can see elevated levels of dopamine and norepinephrine. And then also this one, I'll highlight it here, the serotonin 7-5-HT7 receptor is really an interesting neurochemical target. Lots of data suggests that if you can block signals through the serotonin 7 system, you wind up with an antidepressant effect. The antidepressant effect might be mediated by boosting dopamine output in limbic or frontal areas. So bottom line, many roads lead to increasing dopamine signal. Some people argue that it may increase catecholamine signal. And those are the speculated mechanisms whereby the second generation antipsychotic drugs could elevate mood and provoke mania or hypomania. To summarize, the question is, I guess, a bit controversial, or the statement or the assertion would be that a second generation so-called atypical antipsychotic drugs might induce mania or hypomania. Probably this is a rare effect. I mean, certainly the registrational drug approval trials show that on average, more people benefit from them in terms of mania reduction than don't. But we haven't really looked in detail. We haven't designed studies specifically to try to suss out what is the degree of risk or what's the incidence for mania or hypomania paradoxical effect. And it's biochemically plausible. I mean, we certainly know that antidepressant drugs can cause or provoke mania in people that are susceptible. And many of these atypical antipsychotic drugs do have mood elevating properties. In fact, drugs like lurasidone or quetiapine are approved for depression treatment in bipolar disorder. So globally or conceptually, there's that risk just built into antidepressant action. And the neurochemical pathway whereby that concept could be realized is thought to be due to boosting dopamine or norepinephrine signals in limbic or frontal areas. I just think it's worthwhile to know this and keep that in mind. Certainly, again, my job is a consultant, so I have this really skewed view of the patient care world in which everybody sends to me questions about people that have not gotten better with lots and lots and lots of treatment. And so it's in my practice, it's not uncommon to see somebody who is clearly not well in terms of mania or psychosis and who's on good doses of these medicines. And so it's just helpful to consider the possibility in cases like that, that the medicines might be the problem rather than the solution. Probably it's going to be very rare where that's the case, but I think it's worthwhile to consider that. And then if you do consider that, look for the timeline of when medicines are started and when symptoms evolve. And that sort of gives you an entry into clearer thought about making those decisions.